I think it's only a 30-minute segment, so probably want to adjust the timings on that.
It's a 30-minute segment, Sandeep.
Yeah, it's a 30-minute.
Sorry for the confusion. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm so sorry.
That's fine. Awesome. So, thank you everyone for joining me today. The topic I'm going to talk about is project management in Agile. I am Susmita Vemprala. I'll do a little bit of my introduction at the very tail end. I'll choose to do that. But moving on, I want to get a quick poll out to the group that's out here today and see how many of you have been part of an Agile transformation. I'll just give you a few, Sandeep, or I believe it was
Sonia.
Sandeep, I think.
Sonia.
And Sandeep. Can you help me get the poll out to the group?
Sure.
Awesome. And I see some folks on the chat as well that are messaging out. I take it that most of you being Agile practitioners have at least experienced an Agile transformation or been part of one or championed one in your organizations. I personally have. I've been part of four major transformations in my lifetime as an Agile practitioner myself, and been through multiple frameworks of implementation. All the way from Scrum from a team perspective, Kanban, to some of the scale frameworks like large scale Scrum as well as SAFe implementations. So what exactly is, in terms of, again, from a basic, what does Agile transformation, you typically are starting off from one type of project management, implementation, more often than not, it's your traditional waterfall project implementation, project management ways of doing into the more iterative, cyclic processes of inspect and adapt, with the agile, agile processes. It's mainly, again, not just a shift in process and how you operate, but also a shift in, of course, the mindset from an organization perspective. So when we're talking about project management in Agile, are there any gaps that we can think of, or rather, is there a gap, to be honest? So, most of my experience, to be honest, has always been that, you've got leadership and they are very, all champions through the process of being the change agents that the organization needs. And then, of course, the teams are trained, they get situated, you choose your framework for implementation within the Agile umbrella of doings, and then of course you have you start to work on delivering the value to the customer. But then there are some questions that unwantedly or wantedly there are some aspects of it which are not very, very clearly defined and not necessarily always a clear cookie cut role or a place that we have within the Agile framework that is answered for us. Like say, for instance, how do we track the value delivery across this program? And then more so what happens, what happens when you are asked for, hey, have I done everything to deliver the value? And how far do I have left to go in terms of, my journey towards that value delivery? And then, based off my experience, one of the transformations, a big transformation I was part of in right about 2016 or so, was I was a group product owner for a large, Fortune 100 company, 2,500 people, we've got 50 plus teams. We had awesome leadership backing, but one thing that, and again, teams did an awesome job in what they were expected to do. The transformation went successful, but what the leadership kept on asking for and were still guilty of using terms like, can you tell me where's the roadmap to our journey? And what happens, are we within budget? Is there any metric that I can use to do this? And then of course, the most infamous, famous of them all, where's our status report and how we are doing? And a lot of this stuff is, you know, again, when we're talking about within the traditional project management implementations, we have clear roles that actually have these taken care of. But then what happens when we move towards the agile project management aspect of it? Do we have a clear owner? And frankly, do we need to have one owner in this? So that's, you know, again, there aren't any clear guidelines on who owns this within the agile projects. And again, are these aspects only specific to a traditional project management mentality or implementation? No. And are these owned by a product owner and a scrum master or, you know, in combination of? Not really, if you ask me. So, but that's basically what I'm going to address, or rather just briefly touch upon in my topic today, is how do these project management aspects what does the translation look like when we move to an agile implementation? And then of course, given the time box of this conversation, I'm going to probably touch upon maybe just three of them. And then of course, there's obviously the world of so much more that we can draw as a panel. So let me start off with resource management. Of course, in our traditional project management, we all know that, of course, this is more of a project manager or a portfolio manager kind of a function. But what happens when we start to move towards the agile setup on this? There's a shift in paradigm on this one, right? Because we are no longer planning for resources. We're actually doing capacity-based planning in agile. What does that basically mean? In resource planning, we are talking about, okay, I have a set of resources and how do I efficiently manage them and get to the work that's being promised at the end of the project or the body of work? And then how do I call that successful? Whereas when you're going into capacity-based planning, you're ensuring that, of course, you've got the required skill sets, you've got the resources, and of course, everything else that's needed in terms of what you need to do to deliver value to your business, business stakeholders or your customer, basically. So you're basically shifting from, cross-functional teams that adjust and adapt to whatever is needed to get the value delivery done. So what happens in that case is you have, changing cross-functional, possibly for every iteration. That's based on what I've seen in an iteration planning meeting that's from a skilled agile implementation. I've seen where you have these resources and teams moving from set of resources for one particular iteration to maybe you requiring another, an AWS expert for the next set round because you have a different sort of request, or maybe a mobile expert or UI UX designer that you need for a future iteration. So all of these keeps shifting. So when we do that, of course, the team in itself stays focused on the product team scope, and the scope is, and they are basically talking in terms of, have I done what I've set in place for my product team in itself? And then of course, through this process, have I delivered the value I have promised to my customer? Now what happens to things like, okay, when I have these global teams or these, multiple teams, the reality most of the time that we are all faced with is not all of the skill sets that we need are possibly available in our organization. Possibly they're sourced from other places, and we have, it comes out into the concept of master service agreements. You've got, statements of work that needs to be written. So who does all of that? Are we expecting the product owner to do this, or is it the scrum master's role? And then what happens when we start to scale this up and have it to where you have the same vendor used across multiple teams to source maybe UI experts or AWS experts or some of the other skill sets that possibly may or may not be there within the organization? That is where having a based of where I have gone through in a less, or you know, again, some examples of my experience from the past transformations and implementations that I've been part of, is these are, you know, these vendor management, vendor relationship, contract negotiations, getting to a streamlined process. All of this stays best when it is taken off and loaded and offloaded from the team in itself and handled as a central body outside of. So this is the first, first of the ones. Then of course, another one that comes to mind is budget management. This is a little tricky because, again, as I've already mentioned, we all are aware that POs are focused on scope and the value delivery. They are not necessarily focused on budgets or resources. So now what does that, when I'm talking about within the product in itself, as a PO, I do know what my spend is. Because yes, I have, 5 to 7 people teams, depending on what implementation, maybe 8 to 11. And then of course you have your, rate, or budget amount that you're spending for your resources. And then of course you've got your non-functional requirements as well, other licensing, et cetera, that, fairly stays static if you know that your product is well underway in terms of its delivery. So what happens with, so those are the things that a product owner does manage. But what happens when you start to, again, either scale it or have to, work through the changing needs of a team that is, ever evolving to adjust its resources to fit the needs of what the customer needs or customer wants in terms of the delivery, the value delivery at the end. Is the product team in itself stays focused on that features and the user stories and the throughput on that front. Whereas functions are the paradigm shift that happens is from a, from the traditional project management aspect of it is you have, you're again, not talking in terms of money spent, but the value delivered. And a lot of this value delivery aspect of it, you are not necessarily going to look at it from the centralized, or just from one product perspective. If you have multiple product teams that are collectively coming together and delivering value to the same customer, you are now talking about from an organization level, what is it that I have spent? And then what is it that I have received as return or ROI in this process? So that is where, I have seen the function of you have your alignment to your strategic teams, you have your solution delivery optimized, not just within the team, but across the teams. And you're talking about more on the lines of a portfolio scope or a program level scope, which then make sure that every team that's working in that umbrella of work is working cohesively to deliver that. So obviously this is not something that one product team in itself can help answer or piece the puzzle together. So then what we're looking about, looking to do, or rather at that shift that happens from the traditional project management to the agile world is you start to fund the value streams. You look into concepts like lean budgets or lean, participatory budgets, which again is nothing but making sure that you have inputs from the team levels and having a centralized organizational level function that helps draw the picture of what does that mean in terms of what the management is looking for. Am I well within the budget for what I'm spending, and have I received the value of what I'm expecting? And this based off what I have seen in my experience is, best handled, like for instance, in a SAFe implementation that I've been part of, an agile PMO or a lean portfolio management, function or a body that our team members can help manage this. Or for instance, if you just have, just Scrum teams that are, disjoint, or rather just disjointed products that are collectively from an organizational perspective still delivering value, then maybe something like a finance team that I have seen also, you know, again, that serves as an organization level function that delivers this value, of course. So the third of the ones that I want to quickly touch base on before I sort of wrap up today is one of the most favorite and probably the nemesis for a lot of us is, you know, getting asked for status reports. So a lot of the management that we work with, again, they're not going to change their ways of how they operate, how they speak, and old ways die hard. I mean, it's old habits die hard, right? That's one of the things that we are all aware of. And so you are expected to, like I think in the previous talk I was hearing, Jeff, as an agile coach or as an agile practitioner, you're expected to be the know-it-all on a lot of these things. So you're expected to come up with some sort of a tool or a process that can help you put this all together and give the red, green, yellow, or amber status reports that a project manager typically gets together on a weekly basis and then provide that to the management. But what happens with Agile? We don't necessarily have, we are ensuring that we are working towards keeping that customer happy. Customer centricity comes into mind, right? Because you are looking to deliver consistent, progress, iterative, value to your customer, but you are not looking to, as long as your customer is getting the incremental value and is satisfied, your status still stays the green. And that's what your Scrum Master keeps making sure of within the product team is, they make sure that they are consistently helping remove those impediments. And then of course, there is a lot of status reporting or statuses that the Scrum Master manages from within the team. Like for instance, in a Scrum implementation, one of the things that we're all very familiar with is team velocity charts or burn down charts. So a lot of the Scrum Masters help with this. They do manage and do give us that status reports. But what happens when you sort of take it up a notch and get asked the same thing from a leadership perspective? How often have you sent a burn down chart or a team velocity chart to a leader and they have gotten off your back and like, yes, this is perfect. This is exactly what I was looking for. I've never experienced that sort of bliss in my life in my term of implementation of Agile at organizations that I've been part of, unfortunately. So now what happens then? So then you need some sort of a big picture, something to pull this all together from how good or, you know, how the teams are doing to now bring it back to what am I looking at in terms of an organization level success? Or how far do I have left to go? So that is where I've seen, again, you're talking about in the terms of KPIs to measure your values. You have not just the value or the scope that's delivered from within the product team in itself, but something that can pull this together from across the portfolio or from an across a program perspective. So what happens? So how do we handle these? I have seen success in this scenario specifically. I've seen success in having a portfolio management, a centralized function that actually handles these PMO functions, which not necessarily doing taking the statuses from the teams and putting that together, but more so from trying to draw the big picture of how do I, from a program level, track you through the KPIs, the value that the teams are currently working on. Because we do know that the Scrum Masters, you know, provided that they're doing their what's expected of them, will ensure that the team is continuing and the velocity continues. But how do we track that, how much have we completed aspect of it at the program level? That's where you're again talking about value realization and again portfolio management. So again, one other thing that I know I didn't have time to cover in this presentation specifically was another thing that I get asked is about roadmaps. So just a quick tip on that one. I have seen big room planning. If you have walk the walls is another name for that one, that has really helped me keep my stakeholders in an implementation, whether it is within the teams, you're talking to your business stakeholder from an organization level implementation, big room planning is something that helps the teams and the stakeholders understand and come to the common goal of this is what our vision looks like and this is where and how directionally we are going to progress in making sure that our customer sees and is is constantly kept happy in this equation. So with that, I'm going to wrap up what I have, just a quick, again, based off my experience, sharing how that, the paradigm shift from a traditional project management moves into the agile space. So just in conclusion, we all know that, again, believers in the agile ways of working, we know that it is, of course, a very different different way of working or operations from a traditional project management phase gate approach. And in more ways than none, I don't think I have to, pitch this, but we all know that it is an efficient way of, a program or project delivery. But then what happens to some of those much needed project management aspects and dimensions in the Agile? They do not go away, but what happens is we need support for these individual product teams in itself, and that support can come from a centralized function like a HR or a finance team that stays at the organization level, or in implementations like say if you have a formal body like a PMO or a portfolio management team that comes in to help with this. So that's pretty much what I wanted to conclude with. And then as promised at the end, I want to quickly introduce myself. I have a day job. I'm an enterprise agile coach. Also in my free time, do some safe training or offer some safe training. I do have some community presence with the agilists out here at Houston, Texas, in the US. And I do have, I'm part of the board for Agile Leadership Network at Houston. With most of us, I'm certified in a bunch of things. Those alphabets put together is what you see on the screen out there. And then of course, if you wanna hit me up on LinkedIn or connect with me, I am a big believer in networking being big on forums and conferences such as these. So I would love to have you take a picture of the QR code, hit me up on LinkedIn, and then I'd love to probably connect with any of all of you in maybe a virtual coffee or a chat. So with that, I'd wrap up my presentation. I'll leave this slide on. And then again, Sandeep and Sonia.
Shushmita, we have one question from Anu.